Hello, this is Teleosmos again, and welcome to part 5 of my series on the evolution of muzzleloader design. Tonight, we're going to talk about some of the variants of the guns that are from the 1600s. Unfortunately, since from my last video, I don't have some of the designs in my collection, like the Miquelet or Spanish lock, the Baltic Snaplock, or the English lock, in my collection, so I can't show you some of the transitional types that led eventually to the Flintlock, or otherwise known as the French lock at that time. But I do have two that are from the time period that I think you would find very interesting. The first here is a early style flint variant called the Doglock. Why? Because of this little piece right here holding the cock that is called the dog. As you can see, the lock plate looks like something similar from my wheel lock. Now, in some cases, they have actually replaced the wheel lock if the wheel mechanism had broken with a simpler flint lock type, and some of them were purposely built like that. I think it's a very nice design. This is a replica made by Leonard Day of a Dutch trade gun circa 1650. As you can see, the design of the guns by this time had developed into a club butt with a very long barrel. As I'm going to show you, we're talking a 44-inch barrel here. Now, the flinters at the time, as you can see, have a very squarish type lock. You know, very squarish. I can't think of another word for it. You see, there is no bridle here. It's a simple screw that holds in the frizzen, the one-piece frizzen, to the pan. Now, the interesting thing about these locks, the dog locks, is the fact that they originally developed because from the early English lock, which had a one-piece frizzen and pan cover like so, but they had the lateral sear lock protruding out the lock plate like was in my snob hunts. The problem with that is no half cock. Well, when you had, since you couldn't have the battery to keep the safe, like as a safety mechanism, the chances are that, you know, you could accidentally cause a misfire or have it go off when you didn't want that. That's very bad, especially if someone you don't want to shoot is in the way. So, they developed a very ingenious and simple device that's been called the dog. Right now, this is a vertical seared lock, but at the time, sometimes those locks were not very well made because of the metallurgy of the steel and iron, so it was like an extra safety measure. And let me tell you something. This thing will not go off as long as you got this. Now, the sweet thing about this is that all you have to do is go to full cock, and it pops right out. And just press the trigger. Voila. Cute. Very nice. And this gun is a real good shooter, too. Next gun, you might have seen this in another short video I had, is a variant where you have the standard type flintlock mechanism. At this time period, they had what you call a banana lock because of the shape. But they also had a second mechanism for the matchlock on it. Now, these kinds of locks were common when in the case of a wheel lock with a matchlock, because the pyrites would sometimes break. The pyrites are very easy to break. And this way, they had a more reliable second mechanism that they could still use to fire the gun. It was especially common in hunting guns. But in some of the military circles, like in the Siege of Vienna in the late 1600s, I forgot the date, and some French designs, which is what this one is from, they did also develop flint mechanisms with the matchlock. As you can see, you have a pan cover on the frizzen. And in this particular case, this is what you call the dual trigger lock, which basically has this lever, control one, while you have the flint lock controlled by this trigger. Again, a good sparker. Some designs had it where you could just use one trigger and have a little switch to activate one or the other. I never liked that, because I would think that, you know, a simple little internal mechanism like that, it's a lot more complicated, it could break, then you got nothing. This way, you got separate trigger mechanisms, and the fact is, I do like the lever trigger, because it kind of gives you a little bit more control with the matchlock. This one was based on a design from the late 1600s for Louis XIV in France. As you can see, you have a more familiar design that you would see that would later evolve into Charleville. And the interesting thing about the French, I have probably mentioned it in the other videos, was the fact that the French never gave up on the lever trigger. Most other countries by the 1600s had switched over to a regular trigger with the matchlock. The French never did. You had guns that looked like the Charleville muskets with lever triggers all the way up to 1700. This one's a 72 caliber, built by John Buck as a custom job. And the man did a fabulous job as well. And she's a good shooter. I have actually shot several times both the flintlock and the matchlock and compared the accuracy. I found my groups are a little bit better, about 2 to 3 inches at 25 yards with the matchlock and about 1 to 2 inches with the flintlock. Now we're talking with a 72 caliber using a 690 round ball with a 010 patch and about 80 grains of powder, of 1F powder. And that's about it for tonight. Next, we'll go into the lighter flintlocks. Have a good one and keep your powder dry.